Second important characteristic of any research data collection tool is its validity. What is the meaning of being valid? Validity refers to the degree to which the tool is serving the purpose for which it is prepared. You are preparing a tool with certain purpose in mind, and it should serve that purpose. If you have prepared a tool to measure something, then it should measure that particular aspect or a variable or a characteristic. If you want to check the height, though that weighing machine is accurate, it is not valid. It is not a valid tool because it is not giving you, it is not serving your purpose of measuring the height. Validity refers to the credibility and believability of your research. If your tool is valid, then people would believe that your research is good. The findings will be credible. Because it is a very important aspect of any tool, the researcher has to pay attention. There are different types of validity. For example, content validity, construct validity, criterion validity or instrumental validity, concurrent validity, predictive validity, phase validity. Let us see each type of validity in detail. Content validity refers to the coverage of the content of your research. Which concepts you want to identify? You have already identified. Now every concept will have several attributes, several aspects to it. So do you want to cover all? There may be, apart from concept, there can be processes, procedures, and many other things in your content. Now to give that coverage is very important. You cannot concentrate only on one aspect of it. So if your tool is giving coverage to all the aspects, then it can be valid, and then we are establishing content validity. All the dimensions and elements of that particular concept, process, procedure need to be addressed, but they should be sufficiently representative, comprehensive, as well as relevant. How content validity is established? We have to invite judges who know the subject. You have to tell them the objectives. You have to tell them the content analysis and request them to judge the validity, content validity of your tool. They also will tell you whether each item is useful, whether that item is relevant, whether that item can be included, whether that item is useful but not essential. Not essential also will reflect that it is not relevant. So all these categories of each item in your tool will have to be judged. So content validity is established by external judges who know the subject very well and who will know your objectives after you tell them. Keeping these two things in mind, they will independently give you their judgment on the content validity, which you will have to study it again and find out what other judges are saying. Generally, we invite 3 or 5 judges and get their opinion about the content validity and make the necessary changes if you think that is appropriate. Other type of validity is construct validity. Construct is a special concept in psychological theories and academics. We talk about constructs. They are represented by concepts, theories, ideas. Now, when you establish a construct validity, what is the updated knowledge about these constructs will have to be seen. The word tells you the criterion. Your tool, your statements or the items in your tool are judged on some criteria. So there should be some parallel test available, and that test is used as a criterion measure for testing validity of your tool. Say for example, the driving test. You know that this person has shown good driving skills. Now, what are the things which we should ask him or her in theory? What rules he or she must know? What directions, what interpretations of the visuals he or she must know? Because of that only he or she is driving in a better manner. So now your test, the scores on your test should be nearly similar on the skills which he is representing. The skills he is representing because he or she has the knowledge about these concepts. So there is a criterion, and your tool is tested against that criteria. Concurrent validity, this is also another type of validity which is generally established by using statistical methods, especially of correlation, to other measures like criterion validity. We have seen the criterion validity, but there we have seen the relationship between two criteria, one criteria and your tool. There is another type of validity which is called predictive validity, means you are predicting. What we are predicting? We are predicting for future achievement. We are estimating the relationship of test scores to the respondent's future performance. You have prepared a tool, say attitude towards certain things. This attitude will be the base for having some behavior. Now this behavior will be seen in future. For example, decision maker. The person would be a good manager with reference to decision making. Now the tool which you have prepared today will test his or her abilities today. But you will also be able to predict what will happen, whether this person will be a good manager or not. This is called a predictive validity. The predictive validity will help you to predict, to forecast how well the respondent will be a master or not a master of the trade which you are trying to check. Especially in the field of intelligent test, there are many abilities which we test. So for example, spatial ability. If your spatial ability is good, then you can be good architects, good draftsmen. So now we are predicting, if your scores are good on this tool, you will be good architect. This is the function of a tool as a prediction. And that is why many a times the researcher is interested in establishing predictive validity. The last and the least important is face validity. As the name tells you, it is established by face value. Means they don't require a trained person or a judge. You just see that and have your opinion whether this is valid or not. Sometimes it is used, but as you can see that face validity does not have importance. But if you are in a hurry to do things and then you have to establish a validity, you can just give it to respondents, you can give to your friends and colleagues and ask them to have a look and tell you whether this tool is valid or not. But as you can see, it is not scientifically done, not strictly done. So it is not, you cannot attach so much of importance to face validity. But it is a type of validity which can be established by the researcher. Now that we have seen a reliability of a tool and validity of a tool, and we know what is validity and what is reliability, we know that if the test or tool is measuring what it is supposed to measure, then it is valid. And we know what is reliable, you can rely on it. You can have faith in that. It will not betray you. It will give you the same results again. That is reliability. Now, what is the relationship between these two? You can see that there can be four quadrants. A reliable or a consistent and valid. The tool is reliable and tool is valid. Valid means it measures what it is meant to measure. That means it is a stable construct. There can be unreliable, tool can be unreliable, that is not consistent and not valid. If it is not consistent, it is not valid also. That means it cannot measure what it is supposed to measure. That is why it is giving you two different results at two different times. The third could be, it is reliable and not valid. The tool is reliable, but tool is not valid. And the fourth is, tool is unreliable, not consistent, and still it is valid. Now let us see whether if a tool can be reliable and valid. A test or a tool cannot be valid unless it is reliable. But if it is reliable, it need not be valid. Please understand this. the test results can be reliable, but they need not be valid. We have given that example about testing height and weight. It is accurate, it is reliable. You test it again and again and again, it will give you the same weight. But you are not interested in testing the weight, you are interested in testing the height. So the tool can be reliable, it need not necessarily be valid. But the other way is not true. If it is valid, it needs to be reliable. But reliability is a condition for being valid, but not necessarily sufficient condition for being valid. You see here that three quadrants are correctly represented, but the fourth quadrant, which is unreliable but valid, which is not true. If the tool is not reliable, it certainly cannot be valid, because as we have seen, reliability is a necessary condition for being valid. One more characteristic of a tool is usability. This refers to practical considerations. So you can also call it a practicability, but we will see practicability differs to a little extension. Practicality differs from the usability. Usability of a tool can be seen whether it is usable. Generally, it is administered by people who may not be trained. Generally, it is administered in a hurry. They don't have enough time. Generally, the tool is prepared and administered having very small amount of cost. These are the issues which come in a way for administering the tool, preparation of a tool, finalizing of a tool. So the usability refers to these three aspects. That's why it should be easy to design, it should be easy to administer, appropriately timed. You should have enough time, adequate time in hand for administration. Suppose you have a tool which takes 2.5 hours. Do you think that your respondents will have that much time? Now, if it is an interview schedule and you want to time it 1/2 hour, then after lunch another 1 hour, after dinner 1 hour, do you think you will get the same results? You may not get the same result, because we have seen the reliability of a tool gets affected because of such things. So it is better to keep the length of the instrument to adequate length so that you don't take much time and the respondents are happy to answer that. There also should be ease in interpretation of results. One more aspect which we have already discussed is the cost of administering the test, because there is a cost involved. If this cost is very high, then we know that usability of this tool will go down. For example, if your tool has a lot of diagrams and figures and photographs and you need to print them in color, naturally your cost will go high up. So you will think that instead of giving it to 1000, to reduce the cost, let's go to 500. So you are compromising on the sample size. All these aspects are related to the practicality or usability of a tool. Practicability refers to three things: economy, convenience, and interpretability. One more aspect or a characteristic of a tool is its generalizability. The researcher generally conducts the research on a sample which is selected from a given population. Population is huge and you are selecting a small sample. Administer the test or tool or conduct an experiment on this small sample with a view for generalizability of the results. Though you are working on a small sample, you want to say that the findings or the results can be generalized for the whole population. When you are saying this, of course you have to select a sample which is randomly selected and which represents the population. So as you can see, the generalizability is generally attached to the sample, but it also is a characteristic of a tool. It is an ability to apply the results of research conducted on a sample to the larger population. If your tool does not allow a wider population to be represented, then the generalizability will be at a stake. Say, for example, you want to talk about 8th standard students and you prepare a tool which is comprehensible only by a section. Say only English medium schools, say only urban students. Then the generalizability of a tool is at stake, because you know very well that this will not be understood by Marathi speaking students. You know that this may not be comprehensible for the rural students. So the tool should take care that it would be comprehensible. So while trying it out, or we call it a pilot testing, you have to select sample, small groups of sample from the population. One more characteristic of a tool is its sensitivity. Sensitivity refers to an instrument's ability to accurately measure variability in stimuli or response. If you only say agree, not agree, or if you say strongly agree, strongly disagree, that means you are not sensitive to other aspects in between these two extremes. So how do we increase the sensitivity? We add many more categories on this continuum. Let us see this example. Instead of having only strongly agree and strongly disagree, we can increase the sensitivity by adding strongly agree, mildly agree, neither agree nor disagree, mildly disagree, and strongly disagree. Now you can see that there are 5 categories instead of 2, with a neutral point available in this tool. As the categories increase, scale's sensitivity also increases. This is about the scale. Sensitivity also can be increased by increasing the number of questions on a particular concept. Instead of asking only one question on a particular aspect of that concept, we can add more questions on different aspects, so that you know that the respondent has understood the concept very well. So instead of single item, if you add more items, then the sensitivity increases. We have seen today various characteristics of any tool which is used for data collection by the researcher. As we said in the beginning, each tool has its own characteristic. Each tool is prepared, constructed differently, because these characteristics differ, but there are certain characteristics which are common for all these tools. We discuss those. Keeping that in mind, if you start working on your construction of a tool, then your tool will be more sensitive, it will be more useful, it will be certainly valid and definitely reliable. Thank you.